4 and 5. He who has a slack hand becomes poor, but the hand of the diligent makes rich. He who gathers in summer is a wise son. He who sleeps in harvest is a son who causes shame. Sweet Holy Spirit, we ask that you teach us, lead us, guide us. You said you are the one that teaches us to profit. You are the one who leads us in the way that we should go. Heavenly Father, lead someone here tonight. Lead us away from the place of lack. Lead us into the place of abundance. You are the one who knows where the grass is green. And we thank you because you will cause us to lie down there. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So, two Sundays ago, where did we stop? That was when we were discussing on money and values. We ended up with an exercise, a mental exercise, how to see money. So I asked the question, what is the population of Lagos? And we said there are three figures. The first one by the state government, the other one by the federal government or the National Population Commission, and the third one, citizen figure. So we tried to use the citizen's figure, right? And assumed 15 million. And I asked the question, how much does the average person spend on food in a day? Because, you see, we have said that real money is not physical. The real thing is not visible. So you don't see it with your physical eyes. And what we're trying to do is to teach ourselves to see money, to recognize money. Okay, so we did a little bit of arithmetic. 15 million people multiplied by 300 naira, because that was the average amount of money that we picked. 15 million people multiplied by 300 naira comes to 4.5 billion naira. So if the average person in Lagos spends 300 naira on food in a day, that means that in Lagos, 4.5 billion naira on the average is spent on food in a day. 4.5 billion naira. In 30 days, that is 135 billion naira. 15 million people in Lagos, if each person puts on two pieces of cloth in a day, that is 30 million pieces of cloth, one every day in Lagos. 15 million pairs of shoes, one every day in Lagos. 15 million toothbrushes used every day in Lagos, or almost 15 million because some people don't brush their teeth. Okay. What do they use? Paco. That would still be fair if somebody uses Paco, because that's a local toothbrush. They have to get it from somewhere. Okay. So let's assume 15 million toothbrushes. Those toothbrushes use toothpaste every day. 15 million people, at least almost 15 million people, use soap to bathe every day. Because most people in Lagos hassle and sweat a lot, those clothes get dirty very quick. So those 15 million people need to wash their clothes 15 million people need houses to live in. Those houses need furniture. They need chairs. They need tables. They need beds. The beds need mattresses. The mattresses need bed sheets. They need pillows and pillowcases. A good fraction of the 15 million need to move from one point in this city to the other by vehicles every day. Those vehicles need fuel. They need engine oil. They need parts for replacement. A fraction of the 15 million are children who need schools to attend. These young children need textbooks, they need notebooks, they need biros, pencils, erasers, sharpeners. Can you quantify how much money all that is? We've lost count, right? So somebody is in Lagos who is praying. What kind of a life is this? I've been in Lagos 50 years. Things are hard. There's no money anywhere. Is the person right? With 4.5 billion naira moving around Lagos and exchanging hands on an average day. Somebody says there's no money anywhere. So the truth is, there's money. The problem is, you have not seen it. Because they don't see the real thing with your physical eyes, you see it with your mind. So that's the main lesson today, right? You don't see real money with your eyes, you see real money with your mind. You don't see real money with your eyes. You see real money with your mind. Your number one asset in wealth creation, in converting intangible wealth to tangible wealth, is your mind. When you are someone who has access to revelation, you must understand that the first stage in the conversion of the word to flesh is the mind, conceptualization by the mind. In your composition as a human being, the mind is the bridge between your spirit and your body. The mind is the bridge between the spiritual and the physical. The mind is the conversion equipment. That's why in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, the Apostle Paul said, "Don't let the physical world squeeze you into its mold. You be transformed by what? The renewing of your mind, so that you can prove what is the will of God." In other words, the spiritual provisions that God has made for you will never find expression in the physical, except there's an alignment in your conversion equipment. Very important. So that's why God will not do a thing until he reveals his secrets unto the prophets. When God wants to do something, he says it. So the angel had to appear to Mary. Jesus was going to be conveyed, a spiritual entity, spiritual reality. God wanted to bypass the process. Because all human beings, by some spiritual technology, had been deposited in Adam. And God had to bypass that process and introduce a being that would not take root from Adam. So what the angel did was to speak to Mary. You will conceive a son. You're going to conceive. Mary says, how's that going to happen when I've not slept with a man? The angel said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. And the thing that will be conceived in you will be called the Son of God. Not the Son of Adam. Son of God. Not the son of anybody here. Son of God. Because it's been introduced directly into you. And in Luke 1:45, Elizabeth said, blessed is she that has believed. For there shall be a performance of those things that were told her. So you see, the place where we fail is in the conceptualization. So somebody said, if whatever the mind of man can conceive, it can achieve. It's the conception. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 2, unto us was the word preached as well as unto them. But the word that was preached was not mixed with faith in them. They could not conceive it. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So the place really where we create wealth, where we convert spiritual substance into material substance, is in the mind. Hebrews 3:29, so we see that they could not enter in because of their own belief. I'll tell you this. From what we have discussed so far, you know this, we all are wealthy. Am I right? We're all wealthy. We have intangible resources. We have time. We have gifts. We have talents. And especially for the born-again Christian, access to revelation. We have wealth. The place where we begin to fail is when we entertain self-doubt. Yes, doubt. Hear what Jesus said. Mark 11:23. Whoever will say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea. And he was talking about making things happen in the material world. Say to this mountain, be removed, be cast into the sea, and shall not what? Doubt in his heart. That's the thing that defeats us. I call it self-doubt. So you see, people with awesome opportunities achieving nothing, financially speaking, because of cowardice. And then you see people who seem not to be gifted, who seem not to be advantaged, but who have guts achieving great things. Sometimes, when you act with courage, you surprise yourself just for daring. I'm telling you, somewhere along the line, you in fact exceed your dreams just for daring. Just for daring. That's why God had to speak to Joshua. Be strong and very courageous. There's no amount of teaching we're going to do this series, real money. Some people will still be where they were 6 months from now. Why? They will know everything they're supposed to do, but they won't do anything. Because of what? Fear. Doubt. I pray in the name of Jesus that God will bat in you the boldness that belongs to the righteous. The righteous are as bold as a lion. Okay? So let's move on. Please bear this in mind. You don't see real money with your eyes. You see it with your what? So, What are we talking about? The ability to recognize opportunities.
That's where you make the money.
The ability to recognize opportunities and the equipment that you use for that is your mind. How do you recognize opportunities? Oh, give it another spelling. P-R-O-B-L-E-M. Add S. Problems. Problems. You see, some people are waiting for the big break, the big opportunity. And when the big problem shows up, they run away. But problem and opportunity are the same thing. Find the connection between your gifts and skills and people's problems. You want to turn your spiritual wealth to cash? Find the connection between your gifts and skills and people's problems. The place where you find that connection, sir, is in your mind. So, even as a pastor, I learned that. You know, I learned the hard way that the fact that there are millions of people in the city does not mean they will come to your church. Before I came to this city, people told me, oh, Lagos is, it's the easiest thing to grow a church in Lagos. All you have to do is just open your doors like this. Millions of people just come trooping in. I was now posted to pastor in Lagos. We opened the doors. They were not, as if somebody told them not to come. They were not come. I saw them, you know, I would see a sea of heads moving around the place. To enter here, signboard was not enough. Because Jesus described them as sheep. And as foolish or dumb as sheep are, they know to go where the grass is green. Sheep does not want to die. It may be dumb, but it knows where food is. And sometimes, you know, we have a lot of assumptions. Just like people in business, in church work too, we have a lot of assumptions. Then if we could just get a good auditorium, you know, if we could just get a good auditorium, make sure there's carpet, make sure there's AC. Now, what will happen if you saw the signboard of a restaurant? You went in, they have this beautiful rug. In fact, all their plates are made of gold. They have AC, but there's no food. What would you do? Of what use is a restaurant? If there's no food, is it the plate you will eat? So it's not microphone, no. Because Jesus didn't have microphone when he was talking to people, yet the crowds went after him. Amen. So I discovered that in church work, there's something we call people blindness. And I find out in business it's the same. That we see people every day, but something just blinds our eyes and we don't realize they have desperate needs in their lives. The ability to recognize desperate needs, urgent needs, it's critical to your ability to recognize opportunities for making money. And the tool for doing that is your mind. Okay? I love Acts chapter 8. What happened in Acts chapter 8? Philip the apostle, you know, was doing such an awesome job in Samaria, preaching, people getting saved, miracles and everything, large numbers of people got saved. And then the Spirit of God says, move down to the desert, move down to the road down, that goes down to Gaza. And then Philip gets there and there's coming a car. A limousine. Limo of those days, a chariot coming. Powerful government official from Ethiopia, you know, the finance minister passing by. And he is reading aloud the Bible. So Philip hears. And then the Holy Spirit says to him, join this chariot. Okay? Join this man. So he runs along. And then he hears the man reading. And I like the way Philip approaches it.
to find a need to meet in this man's life.
You see, the challenge I see a whole lot of time is many people don't realize that rich people have needs. I'm telling you, they do, sir. They've got needs. There's nobody in this world who does not have needs. Am I right? In fact, part of what defeats us sometimes is the fact that we don't realize not all needs are material. People have spiritual needs. They have emotional needs. They have psychological needs. They have physical needs. They have material needs. They have financial needs. So Philip comes by. Hears the man reading. Says, where can I touch this man? And throws a question at him. Says, sir, do you understand what you are reading? The man said, how can I understand except somebody explains it to me? I can explain, sir. He said, then come on board. That was it. Can you recognize people's needs? Okay, if it was business he wanted to do, he would make money. Can you recognize people's needs? You must develop the ability to recognize people's needs. If you want to make money, it's not enough for you to carry things around. Do people need it? So the fact that people are selling, it doesn't mean anything. Can you recognize needs? The more you develop sophistication in recognizing needs, the more money you're going to be able to make. Great opportunities are not seen with your eyes. They are seen with your mind. Great opportunities are not seen with your eyes. They are seen with your mind. Okay, so I'll encourage you. Number one, get education. Get education. There are different kinds. But the important thing, get education. And understand the purpose of education. Okay? In our country, we get educated so we can have certificates. So we can get jobs. But the word education is from the Latin word educo, from which we have the English word educe, which means to bring forth from within. The essence of education is the training of your inner faculties to recognize opportunities and to create solutions to situations. That's the essence of education. So when you look, therefore, at the essence of education, you will realize many people go to school in this country, but they are not educated. See, the ultimate objective of education is problem solving. Am I right? When somebody's been trained for 6 years in the medical school, what do you think, what kind of problems will he recognize in the society? Sicknesses and diseases, health problems. Say, excuse me, the way you are breathing, something's wrong with your lungs. And a normal person won't see that. Let me check your BP. What's BP? Is it British Petroleum or blood pressure? Let me check your BP. He said, you're a walking dead man. He said, there's nothing wrong with me. You're the one that has a problem. Say, you are sick. He said, you are sick. But what I can see? A normal person won't see that. Your eyes are yellow. That means something. 6 years of conditioning the mind creates the capacity to spot opportunities. Because when the doctor solves problems for you, he collects money in exchange. Because he spotted an opportunity to add value. So get education. Okay? It's important. And please, you see, Don't study just to pass examinations. Study to develop your mind, to sharpen your mind, to develop the ability to recognize problems and to be able to create solutions for them. That's the essence of education. I'll encourage you, get financial education. After getting education, maybe as a doctor, lawyer, accountant, secretary, you know, whatever it is you may have learned. Of course, there's practical education that you get through apprenticeship. Get financial education. Because sometimes you can recognize the opportunity to solve problems for people, but not recognize opportunities to make money. They are two different things. Because you solve problems for people at different levels. And I'll come back to that later. Get financial education. Okay? There are basic skills. I think they fall into four categories that you need to acquire in terms of financial education. Number one, accounting knowledge. Accounting skills. Accounting, you need to be able to add figures. Okay? You need to get some basic accounting vocabulary. You need to know what an asset is. You need to know what a liability is. You need to know what net worth means. You know what? Your expertise in any field is tied to its vocabulary. Yeah. What makes a lawyer a lawyer? It's the vocabulary. Sine qua non. Locus tandi. Que sera, sera. Those Latin words, those are the words that make you a lawyer. They have English equivalents. Speak English. Okay? It's a vocabulary, the legal vocabulary, knowing the law, and so on. So, you need to understand the language of the rich. And part of it is some accounting vocabulary. It's very important. You really need to know what an asset is. An asset is not just anything you buy. That's what people with minimum financial literacy tell you. But there are things that you buy that continually take money away from your pocket. Rich people don't call them assets. They're liabilities. Anything that puts money in your pocket is an asset. Anything that takes money out of your pocket is a liability. Your net worth. Add up the value of all the things you own. Then add up the value of all the money you owe. Submit what you owe from what you own. Then you have your net worth. Okay? There's something they call cash flow. You need to understand that. That's the amount of cash that you have flowing. So you need to get some accounting skills. You need to get investing skills. You need to learn investing skills. Investing skills. And that's the ability to put your money somewhere and to get it to generate more money for you. Now, this is very critical. Okay, investing skills. Then you need marketing skills. Marketing skills. Marketing skills. And you need some legal skills. You need some legal skills. Marketing skills, I mean, you need to know how to sell something. You need to know how to sell. I'm telling you. You know, I said, you've got to find the connection between your gift and skill and what people need. You need to find the connection between your product and what people need. I don't care what that product is and how powerful it is. I learned as a preacher, you can have the most powerful message in this world. You can have all the anointing in this world. If you cannot direct it at specific needs in people's lives, they'll be looking at you. Unable to see how what you are offering will add any value to their lives. That's what marketing is about. Your ability to recognize people's needs and to help people to see how what you have will meet those needs.
Now, that's some skill, sir. That's some skill. You need selling skills.
I was reading Robert Kiyosaki's book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and he talked about how he was having this media interview with a journalist in Singapore. And powerful journalist, said he had read a few of her articles, powerful, strong, direct. But then she was lamenting to him about how people were not buying her books. She had written powerful books, but people were not buying. So Kiyosaki said to her, I think you need to get to go to school. You need to attend a course on selling. She said, that's one thing I don't like. Salespeople are, selling is beneath my dignity because I feel that what they teach salespeople is manipulation. They look for ways to manipulate people, to buy things. I'm not interested in all that. So Robert Kiyosaki said he observed that she was angry. In fact, she began to pack her papers. That was the end of the interview. So he said to her, as she was packing her papers, he picked this book, you know, and pointed to something on it and said, you see, that is it. She said, what? I said, that is it. She said, what? Best-selling author. He said, yes. You see, that is it. I am a best-selling author, not best writing author. So you can be a best writing author, but not be a best selling author. You will read your book yourself. Kiyosaki said his first book, he titled it, If You Want to Be Rich, If You Want to Be Happy and Rich, Don't Go to School. So he said when he gave the script to the publisher said, no. The publisher suggested another topic, the economics of education or something like that. He said, he told the publisher, sir, if I use that title you are proposing, I will sell only 2 copies. One to my family members, the other one to myself. He said he didn't take the publisher's advice. He said it was deliberate. He said he is a champion for education. He knows what he's doing. But the issue here is that he wants people to buy the book. He said he went ahead and used his title. The book sold and sold and sold. Out of curiosity, let them buy it. When they get inside, they get... Listen, if you want to sell a very bitter medicine, bitter pill, what do? You tell people, bitter. Bitter, this thing is bitter. Even if you tell them it will cure them, the bitterness will drive them away. So you coat it. That's right. You coat it. When it gets inside, it will do the job that it's supposed to do. Am I right? Some people don't like us using marketing terminologies, branding, whatever. It's just common sense. They're principles because you're dealing with human beings, not trees and not stones. And human beings have emotions. Am I right? So selling is a skill, and we've got to acquire marketing and selling skills. And then legal skills. In every location where you are, there are legal parameters. You need to know what is legal and what is not, because you can make a lot of money and end up in jail. So you don't want to break the law. There are always legal means for making money. All right. I think this is also important. Have a mentor. Have a financial mentor. Have a financial mentor. I can't tell you how much loss I have been saved from by having a mentor.
What will a mentor give you?
Ideas, right?
Information, knowledge. But in the school of real money, that's the money. Am I right? That's it. It is stupid ideas that make us poor.
That's all.
It's thinking, it's thoughts that make us poor. Nobody is poor. Anybody who thinks he's poor, is poor. It's the thinking. So you need to hang around people in the first place who will introduce some amounts of money into your mind that you would not think about on a normal day.
Am I right?
Yeah, everybody's keeping quiet. Because it can be stressful and very threatening for you to hang around people who are talking about 1 million naira, 10 million naira, just in case they pounce on you, ask you to bring some amount of money that you cannot afford. So we prefer not to hang around people like that. I can't forget the day I was discussing with two ministers of gospel in this city, elderly people, much older than myself, and they were discussing about their investments. It's many years ago. Many years ago. When my salary in this church was it 4,000 or 6,000 naira? And so they were discussing, and one of them said, you know, that property, you know, I just sold it. He said, I got a loan for 500,000 naira in 1973 from Union Bank. You know, I bought the land and built the building. And I sold it for 17 million naira. The other one too shared his own testimony. But that one building in Yaba that he just sold, said the thing had penthouse. He mentioned the millions that he sold the building for. Then the one that sold the house for 17 million naira talked about the building that he bought on Obakran, you know, many years ago, and that he just sold it, you know, just sold it to a bank for 34 million. He said it was part of the money that he got there that he used to build the 6 block of flats that he just finished behind his house. And that, you know, I built it for, how much did he say he built it for? Was it 30 million? And he said, that was, you know, that was just last year. And I brought the valuers and the value was 45 million. You know, I was just smiling and nodding my head. You know what they say? Rich people are talking, the poor man too said he has an idea. I didn't have any idea that day at all. I was just nodding and smiling. They were giving me stress. They were stretching my mind. I was hoping they would not ask me any question because as far as what they were discussing was concerned, I was out. That was not my area of jurisdiction. But I'm glad that I sat down at least. Because I heard something. Jackie Kennedy, you know, powerful woman. She used to be wife, former American president, John F. Kennedy, and then married this powerful Greek billionaire, Aristotle Onassis. She said once, if I become broke, I know what to do to pick myself up again. Said I would go to the most expensive restaurants in New York. I would buy myself a glass of water and I will eavesdrop on the conversations of the rich. That's all. Amen. The conversations of the rich. So that's why it's important for you to have a financial mentor. I'm serious. There are stupid mistakes I could have made over time that I've not made. There are strong values I have developed over time. Strong values. There are things I just won't do anymore. Things that kill the... You'll be surprised. Many of the things that poor people do that they think will help them to become rich are the things that make them poor. But you just never rise beyond the level of your knowledge. He who walks with the wise will be wise. Acts chapter 4 verse 13, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and saw that they were ignorant and unlearned men, uneducated men, they marveled. And then they realized that they had been with Jesus. That was the only explanation for the result they were producing. So that's why I said earlier on in one of our messages that many people, I have heard people say, oh, you know, there's a lot of money that has passed from Bishop Oyedepo to Pastor Sam. Many people believe it, you know. And I said that I was going to tell us how Bishop Oyedepo gives me money. And I said it's intangible wealth that he gives me. It's just the counsel, the advice, the thoughts, sometimes just the inspiration. The fact that I have the opportunity of going into an environment that is way ahead of where I am. And I have the opportunity of going there consistently. And at first, some of those things blow my mind. But after going there several times, they don't blow my mind anymore. They become normal. And the Holy Spirit said to me, when it becomes normal in your mind, it has become normal in your life. For all spiritual people, you understand also that grace is transferable. Yeah. Grace is transferable. You can get it from someone who has it, and it can work for you exactly the way it's working for that person. In Acts chapter 10, the disciples of Jesus came back. You read verse 17. They came back and said to him, the devils were subject to us in your name. What was working for you has been working for us. I remember many years ago, the day I was driving behind a car. Now, this car belonged to a neighbor. And they were using it for school runs. It was just when the Lincoln Navigator, the first few of them, came into this country. And somebody was using it, somebody's driver was using it to do school runs with the children. I was also doing school runs with my limo. Okay, my used car. So one day, I was driving behind the car, you know, on the way back home, and I had the opportunity to meditate. That's where it happens, sir. That's where your eyes open. That's where you do permutations and combinations in your favor or against you, okay? So now, as I was looking at the car and remembered that my mentor had one, I spoke out. I said, you, this car, I have the capacity to own you because my mentor owns one of you. And the grace that I am taking from him is not the one he had 10 years ago. It's the one he has now. Since he has you, I have capacity to get you. You will manifest for me in due season. It was mentoring that gave me the opportunity to do such appropriations to myself. So I want to encourage you, have a financial mentor. Some people's financial mentors are their friends who are on the same level. Who do you listen to? It's very important. In an environment where people suspect the rich, mind them. The rich also cry. So that's your consolation. All right, let's get to the last part of it. Be a problem solver. Work hard. I want to talk about work because that, you know, when your mind spots the problem, your mind can design a solution. Your physical body has to take practical steps. Some of people's needs are material.
Okay?
A car is a material thing. A microphone is a material thing. A TV set is a material thing. And they need to be crafted physically. Food is material. It needs to be crafted. It needs to be carried. It needs to be served. So some part of the work is mental. The other part is physical. Whatever or whichever is required, you must be willing to do it. He who has a slack hand becomes what? Poor. Work is not a curse. It's a blessing. In Genesis chapter 2, God put Adam in the garden to till it and to care for it. So God gave man work to do long before the fall of man happened. It's the productivity that God cursed. It was the soil that he cursed. Work is not a curse. 6 days you shall work, God said. On the seventh, rest. God wants us to walk. God designed for us human beings to walk. When we don't, we disintegrate. We function beneath our potential. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 28, let him that stole steal no longer, but rather let him walk with his hands. What is good? 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 10, he who does not walk should not eat. Work builds us. Work develops us. Work builds our character. There are qualities that work will develop in you. You've developed the ability to set goals, your ability to move yourself, to set targets, and your ability to stay on a job. The ability to correct yourself when you make a mistake because you are not God. You are not perfect. So sometimes while you are trying to produce something, something goes wrong. Your ability to start again. Your ability to stay with something from start to finish, which builds in you perseverance. All the circumstances that you meet in the process of achieving a goal change you. See, I tell people when we talk about achieving goals. The reason why the life of a person who sets and achieves goals is radically different from that of a person who doesn't have a goal is in the bid to achieve your goal, you change. My income today is 1,000 naira per month. My target, 50,000 naira per month. I have to become a particular kind of person to attract 50,000 per month. My capacity presently is attracting 1,000. And every human being is a living magnet. So something has to happen to my magnet for me to be able to attract 50,000. In the process of achieving your goal, you stretch. While the bricklayer is building the building, the building is building the bricklayer. In the process of achieving, I tell people, for example, if I want to tell you how to achieve your vision, I tell you, first of all, become the person in the vision. That's the point. Because that is the magnet that attracts everything else in the picture. So work builds our character. The lazy person who avoids work misses out on many things. Work builds us. All honest work is honorable. All honest work is honorable. I've said that before. I have more respect for the cleaner who earns an income legitimately for an executive who steals. In the eyes of God, the person who earns a small amount of money is more valuable. All honest professions are honorable. It's important for us. Listen, if you don't respect other people who do basic jobs, nobody will respect you.
And you know what?
Part of the reason, one of the reasons why we miss the opportunities to make a lot of money in this country is because we despise what we call lowly jobs. I realize in this country that there are vulcanizers who fare better financially than graduates. Vulcanizers in dirty jobs and dirty overalls who make more money, build houses, send their kids to very good schools and prepare a good future for them. And you have graduates tying ropes around their necks who are suffering and broke. Once you go through the university system, something enters your brain that tells you that that kind of a job is beneath your dignity. And I think that a graduate who takes over the vulcanizer job will take it to a higher level. And it is not everybody who likes to park by the roadside to have them gauge his tire with gauge that was manufactured 22 years ago. And it is very, very unreliable. It will produce three different readings from the same tire if you put it three times. Am I right? The days of thinking a mechanic's job is for non-entities, those days are over. Many of the mechanics now, roadside mechanics, are going to be out of work 10 years from now because the cars they are manufacturing now, when you open the hood, there's nowhere to put a screwdriver. You use computers to check what is wrong with them. That's where the money is. Okay? All honest work is honorable, sir. Honorable. And let me add this thought. Don't work for money. Doesn't that sound strange? Don't work for money. Rich people don't work for money. It's poor people and the middle class that work for money. And when they want to make more money, they work harder and work longer. Don't kill yourself in the bid to make more money. Proverbs 23 verse 4, Solomon said, labor not to be rich. Don't increase the stress. There's no point in making money and losing your health in the process. There's no point in making more money and losing your family in the process. Because some people have pursued money, pursued just to rise to the height of the ladder. And by the time they got to the height of the ladder, there was no wife and children left at home. Okay? So what do you mean? Don't work for money. Okay? Work to learn. Don't work for money. Work to learn. Work to learn. Work for yourself. Work to achieve your goals. Work to become the kind of a person that will attract the kind of wealth that you want. And you know that the key is your mind. Work to develop your thinking. I'm telling you, some of the greatest investments you will make in your life are the investments that you make into your thinking. That's where the power is. So developing that ability to recognize opportunities, that's what I'm talking about. So work to increase your expertise. Don't work for a paycheck. People stay on that level for too long if that's their ultimate goal. Don't work for a salary, sir. It's something that I say to our staff all the time. Don't work for a salary. A salary is one of the least rewards you will get for working. I'm serious. The greatest reward you get for working is the person you become in the process of working. So some people, therefore, work in an organization. And because they said their job is accountant or secretary, they get boxed in to to that small corner of the job. And interestingly, sometimes they work directly with the CEO. You see what I'm talking about? If you have a vision to become a CEO while you are accountant or administrator, you will not just be working to do your job well as an administrator so that they can pay you very well at the end of the month, and then at the end of the year, they give you 10% pay rise. No. If your vision is to become a CEO, you will be watching. You have the opportunity of reading all the letters, all the communication. You attend all the meetings. What are you picking? What are you learning? That's what I'm talking about. What makes the CEO the CEO is the way he or she thinks. Once you start thinking at that level, it will show in the proposals and the ideas that you bring to the table in the organization. Some people have jumped in organizations just because of the quality. I did. Because of the quality of ideas that they bring. In fact, some people, they create a new department or a new subsidiary altogether to test their ideas or to drive their ideas. Don't work to earn. Work to learn. What you learn will determine what you earn. Don't work for money. Rich people don't work for money. They make their money to work for them. You earn money on four levels, like Robert Kiyosaki says. You earn money on four levels. You earn money as an employee. That's the lowest level. That's why I'm encouraging, don't stay there. Don't stay there. You earn money as an employee, then you earn money as a self-employed person. That's when you start your business, but you are the only employee. You are the CEO, you are the purchasing officer, the marketing officer, admin officer, IT manager, the accountant, you are the secretary, you are the PA to the CEO. But then from there, you move on to become a business owner. A business owner is someone who employs other people to do the job. You have the ability to build systems, design organograms, recruit people, train them, get them to do the job. It's a completely different level from being self-employed. And then the fourth level, an investor. You earn money as an investor. That one, you put money in places where other people are doing the job. They do all the work. They make the money. You collect your share. What makes the difference between all those four levels? The way they think. So, while you are working, target where you want to be. Set your personal goals financially and decide where you want to be. If you want to make money, you want to be wealthy, you want to be rich, target the business owner level and the investor level. So while you are an employee, more than the salary you will get, sir, learn everything you can about being a business owner and being an investor. Yes, the word that the Holy Spirit gave me that resulted in this series is the fact that he is raising in this church not just millionaires, but multi-billionaires. And in the name of Jesus, the Son of God, I receive grace for you tonight. I receive grace for you tonight. I receive grace for you tonight. Receive capacity to recognize opportunities. Receive open eyes in the name of Jesus Christ. Where others have not seen, you will see. What others have not heard, you will hear. The Spirit of the living God will inspire you in the mighty name of Jesus. The problems of this city have become your opportunities. Goliath was Israel's problem. For David, it was an opportunity. I prophesy in the name of Jesus that the problems of this nation have become your own opportunities. Some people look at the population of Nigeria. They see 150 million problems. Some foreigners come in here, they see 150 million opportunities. I was in Canada a few weeks back. I was shocked when they told me the population. Canada has this, is the country with the second largest landmass in the world. Their population, 31 million. Nigeria, 150. Oh my God. If you sell something to just 1 million people per year, and you make just 100 naira on each of them, that's 100 million. Am I right? If you sell something to just 10,000 people per day, and you make 10 naira from each of them, 10,000 people per day, 10 naira. But you do that 25 times every month. My brother, do the calculation. You will sell something. In the name of Jesus, the Son of God, heaven will deliver to you a solution. You will get a design. The Holy Spirit will use your imagination as a receiving station for new inventions, creative solutions. In the name of Jesus. Where people see problems, you will see opportunities. In the mighty name of Jesus, where people's brains stopped working, yours will get creative solutions. In the name of Jesus Christ. If what you need to know to be a problem solver is in a book, my God will bring that book to you this year. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, your gifts will be exposed. Your potentials will be realized. There will be a